that were made by AU member states to channel no less than 0.1% of GDP respectively towards R and B. 0.1%. We are not even fulfilling that. We will be left behind to do that. Fellow Namibians, others who are here, where fourth industrial revolution is predicated mainly in artificial intelligence, and where artificial intelligence is the technique of making machines intelligent, it has become ever more important to become owners and developers of technology. If you don't own them, we'll be left out also. We'll beg somebody to give us something. But with that, we must also develop and become owners. This is because the development of any technology embeds the norms, standards, values, stereotypes, and cultural innuendos of its developers. That's when Namibians are not designing and creating their own digital technologies, nor have the critical mass of specialists, it risks inadvertently adopting a different culture through the technologies that it consumes. If I'm going to get technology from somewhere else, I'm probably how about my own culture? I will do things, so I have to adopt that culture. And I must even tell myself, don't do it that way. When they don't do the African or cultural way, we are supposed to live up to when you commit to that culture, how they do it. The solution lies in us increasing our technological skills and national capacity to co-design and co-create contextually relevant technology across the various dimensions of our development, including application to healthcare, energy, education, defense, agriculture, Minister of Agriculture, Finance, Minister of Finance, Trade and Commerce, etc. Although we may not yet be the owners and developers of technologies at scale, we do own a very important aspect. Very important aspect, the data or the data. The data is ours, and open data has become a sought after capital resource of its own innate value. Unlocking information management systems and interoperability within the public and private sectors will inform smart and intelligence-driven development and governance. This is what we are striving towards. This is the direction in which we are heading. A green economy is defined by the United Nations to be low carbon, resource efficient, and socially inclusive, where growth in employment and income are driven by public and private investment into such economic activities, infrastructure and assets that allow reduced carbon emissions and pollution, enhance energy and resource efficiency, and prevention of the loss of biodiversity and ecosystem services. Namibia has embarked on a green future, where we are positioning ourselves as a global producer of green hydrogen and ammonia. Because of that, we were at the World Economic Forum. I think Namibia House was very important, very popular. Because I thank my colleagues who set up that Namibia House. But for the first time, we invited, and I think we did our best there. Not only do we want to produce green hydrogen for the world, but we want to utilize This new industry will serve as catalyst for Namibia's rapid adoption of fourth industrial revolution technologies, while positively contributing to the global fight against climate change. Fourth industrial revolution technologies contribute to this green economy as an enabler for production and advanced manufacturing systems, communication, network, education, healthcare, government, and community services. To demonstrate under a memorandum of understanding that is executed by University of Namibia on behalf of government, Namibia is already receiving carbon credits for using blockchain technology to develop a verifiable record of green hydrogen production. Projects are also underway to teach our youth to develop drones and bush aircraft. Last week, the Namibia Institute of Pathology, in partnership with the UNICEF, showcased the drones that will deliver and collect medical specimens to remote communities in the Kunene and Sambesi. This will significantly reduce diagnosis waiting time and enable prompter commencement of treatment for our citizens in remote and rural areas. Likewise, drones can be used for surveillance to cap crimes such as poaching and in agriculture for pests and disease control. Unlocking the full social and economic benefit from this type of fourth industrial revolution and enabled sub-projects will require a coherent policy and regulatory framework, such as licenses and authorization to operate drones in the airspace for such critical missions. So, the Minister of Police here. Yeah, Minister of Police. You will like that since you came from the exile also. We are so suspicious. So please allow people to have this room. Don't think any CIA is coming down here. It's our way of thinking. I commend the pioneering effort of the Namibia Institute for Pathology and encourage the stakeholders involved in the execution of this pilot project to ensure its success and sustainability. Moreover, the Namibian government has prioritized focus on agriculture as one of the sectors in addition to health, finance, defense, and education, where fourth industrial revolution technologies can be used to increase production, create new jobs, and ensure food security for our nation. Enterprise development will focus to inculcate culture of entrepreneurship and strengthening innovation value chains has been central to our economic recovery, growth, and investment promotion initiative. The governance of technology and innovation can create convergence of technology and innovation can create valuable industries for job creation in sectors like fintech, edutech, healthcare, agritech, which are all underrated by the creative industries who design, code, and develop the soundtrack themes for these technological advancements. To this end, as a special project undertaken, the Fourth Industrial Revolution Task Force has been working jointly with the World Economic Forum to develop a fourth industrial revolution policy and legislative toolkit for use to ensure compliance and future-proof in the wake of, for use to ensure our policy and legislative instruments are fourth industrial compliant and future-proof in the wake of leapfrogging technologies which double in capability on average every 18 months. Namibia has embraced the information age, which brings with it online media and round-the-clock breaking news through some kind of unplanned discoveries. As a responsive government, we are leveraging these tools to enhance public access to information and enhance accountability to all Namibians. Public communications, especially during our national response to COVID-19 pandemic, revealed the extent to which social media has become a tool to spread misinformation and disinformation. According to the reporters of our borders, Namibia currently occupies the number two, we have been number one for a long time, number two position on the continent as a country with the freest press. She says, I think did better, not that we went down. We moved down from number one to two in Africa, but we moved up from number 24 to 18 position in the world. I once again reaffirm the commitment of the Namibian government to the fourth stage. However, I call for deeper societal reflection on media ethics and professionalism in this era of artificial intelligence. That one is very important. We should be reminded that rankings indices are perception based, and we were collectively responsible for the image that we project. Our press, our media says anything, not caring about a person's reputation. And persons, I mean, some of us feel very much about ourselves. They just say anything. They don't say how you are damaging your image. And at this age, some of us created ethics that we live to for a long time. The press has to be careful. The media and civil society have a key role to play and must be mindful of the information they convey and its impact on society. Character proceedings. Young Namibians and their peers across the continent are more integrated and connected than what they have ever been. Only to approve access to the internet and mobile telephony, resulting in an intensification of actors and rise of what is termed the second trade diplomacy, enabled by digital channels and social media. The information age has brought knowledge to the fingertips. Today, even the most remote young Namibian child can, and at the click of a button, witness the access, opulence, and privileges of other members of the Namibian house, bringing the inequalities existing in our society to the fore, and resulting in feelings of frustration and despair. This can create hope to the same extent that it can create a sense of injustice and impatience from government to deliver on these race expectations and progressive processes that we are using in the cities. We are proud of what we have achieved, rightly so. But the knowledge is now available to those who are in the bush. And I see how we are living here. We are in the same country and say, why am I not there too? Same way we are doing through the struggle. We fought to be equal for those who are privileged. But after we got there, we are there now. And others are saying we have to be there too. And if we are not careful, not address those frustrations, beautiful Namibia, peaceful Namibia, boasting about it, can be in trouble. Youth unemployment. started to give education to the left out. That education, school for all, creates problems for us. First started the classroom situation. St. Paul's Secondary School, not enough classrooms. Not good teachers. The quality went down. So we have people with degrees who are at home and are waiting for the day they may get a job too. Today's National Policy Dialogue on Technology is therefore aimed to inform three distinct groups of stakeholders amongst us. One, the government as a central tool to unlocking efficiencies in the delivery of public services and bringing services closer to the people. B, number two, the education sector, Honorable Minister, in terms of human capacity development and preparing our labor force for a changing future. And third, industry. Industry who underwrite investments to boost the capabilities and competitiveness of local firms. So all three of us were given, have been addressed here. As we follow the discussions of the day, let us therefore remain mindful of the challenges limiting our collective ability to harness these technologies and approach the subject from a solution mindset that will enable us to draw better engagement and coordination across sectors. As I'm closing the rest of the city, we are acutely aware that rapid technological advancements not match with requisite levels of investment bear the risk of leaving more people behind and widening the inequality in our society. Owing to the pervasive nature of these technologies, we cannot escape from or entirely avoid a digital future. We must therefore put people at the center of social and economic changes. Special focus must be paid towards rural development strategies so as to ensure marginalized communities and young people who are facing unique challenges are supported equitably to break out of cycles of poverty. For the technology to be a force for development for all Namibians, it must reach everyone. Without resolving rural electrification, our people cannot connect to electric systems, such as e-government, despite our best efforts. Without digital skills and literacy, the full potential of internet connectivity will remain unrealized. Without infrastructure sharing, access and affordability, inequality will remain defining limitations for a vast majority of our citizens. Without the requisite digital rights in frameworks to protect and enforce citizens' rights online, women and children will continue to ensure digitally enabled violence and violations. Engendering digital transformation and embracing a digital economy and digital future will require a shared national vision to inform a holistic and integrated strategy. An enduring partnership and quadruple helix between the government, the private sector, academia, civil society, and the youth is a conditional sine qua non. The time has come for the rights guaranteed for every Namibian by our supreme law, our constitution. Ever for the remainder of my term as the President of the Republic of Namibia to champion these critical reforms together with the whole government. And I'm glad many of the ministers are here. I'm now making a pledge that for the remainder of my to champion this political reform together with the whole government towards improved quality of the life of all Namibians. For this, I'd like to thank you.